Hello everyone. This is the second theoretical classes of this course, Service Design and Innovation, and I'm going to focus more on one aspect of service design, which is the design of service interactions. And as you are at the second semester of the course, I'm sure you've already been touching into this aspect of service design in when you're been approaching projects or studying visualization. This lecture is divided in two parts, again because of the registration, the creation of the video. So I will first introduce the design for services map, and then I will go deeper into the concept of service interaction and service encounter. The map of design for services is a visualization that was created in a first book that I made with Anna Meroni on design for services when this discipline was really at the beginning. So it was published in 2011 and it was built in the previous 3 years. So we are really at the beginning of this field. And I was in UK. So the effort we made was to conduct research from bottom up. So instead of looking for literature that was almost not existing, we looked for case studies. So based on these case studies and interviews and collection of writings from other authors, we created this visual map. So the aim was to interpret ongoing practices. So we involved six design companies and eight academic research centers in the world that somehow were starting to work in this field, this new field of design research, and one research center within a big company, which was IBM. So many of these actors are still active today in service design from different perspectives. What we did was to collect these different contributions and case studies, and then with Anna, we during a period where she was in Lancaster visiting me, we made this exercise to try to understand what was emerging from data, no? As we do when we do the design research. As you can see from our hairstyle, it was some years ago. And so out of this exercise where we try to look for which were the roles of design, what kind of projects was conducted, what kind of approaches they were using, and so on, we started to create this map that we gradually adjusted, which sees at the center the core, the qualities, the core quality of service design. Then we identify four main areas of intervention, and within this, we identified eight main kinds of design contributions. So this is a map now that has 9 years, so it is not necessarily representing completely the current scenario, but it's still very coherent with how service design somehow has been manifested, and you can still use this map somehow to orient yourself. So, as I was saying, this is a map with at the center the core quality of service design, which is to be a human-centered approach. And then there are these four main areas, which are design interactions, relations, and interfaces, which is the area that we will look into today. Then design interactions to shape systems and organizations, designing new collaborative service models, and imagining future direction for service systems. And then within this, you will be able to see specific contribution that in the lecture, the following lectures, we will go a bit deeper. So, as I was saying, at the center of this map, there is the core quality, the core characteristic of service design, which is the fact that designers, as you well know, always start from trying to understand people. People, the that are not just users, customers, but they are also, for example, service suppliers, the staff or partners or relatives of users. So this interest and understanding of people, their behaviors, their attitudes, their dreams, their capacities are the fundamental step, the first, the core aspect of any design action in service design as well. As I was saying, today we focus on one specific area of this map, which is designing interactions, relations and interfaces. This is associated with a specific interpretation of service design that we touched upon during the last lecture, which is understanding services as interactions, as experiences, as performances, no? Everything somehow that is happening beyond the visibility an interaction line with the user, between the service system and the users. So when we consider projects that work in this area, design for services focus on evaluating designing service experiences, relations and interactions. So the aim in this kind of projects is to design better services by improving and enabling better experiences and supporting more empathic and effective interactions among people and the service system. So so the focus is really on what are the current experiences, how interactions are currently happening, and what can we do to make it more effective, more empathic, more usable, and so on. So we enter this specific area of study, and of course service design is not the first to look into this area. There are many studies, for example, coming from marketing research, service marketing, which is a more established area of studying service, for example, or service research in general. So if we consider why we tend to consider the analogy between an interactive product and a service, we can see that the commonality is the fact that we are both designing an interaction. And that's why somehow service design is starting to look into interaction design as a possible source of inspiration. So many of the tools, all the concepts, the language that has been used in interaction design is also and can be used also in service design. And in fact, you can see that often service design has a special relationship with interaction design courses or interaction design discipline. But we're not talking about products, no? We're talking about interactive products. There has been an evolution in the understanding of service design, no? In the really first studies on this topic. Initially, service was considered as a product. So the idea that even if it's a service, you still need to use design process and design applications. A PhD done by Elena Pacenti in 1998 instead introduced and suggested the possibility to compare service as a complex interface. So if we conceive service as a complex interface, then inevitably we associate service design with specific kind of competencies and tools and interpretations. If you remember the four dimensions that define a service, this lecture is specifically about the ones that interpret service as an interaction, as a performance, and as an interface, a complex interface. So it's not just the interface of a mobile phone, no? But a service interface is made by many different kind of elements that enable the service delivery and the service fruition. Given this analogy between service design and interaction design, from the beginning, there has been, as I was saying, this connection with the school's research methodology of interaction design discipline. So still today, you can see that in interaction design institutes, research centers, and so on, service design is necessarily one of the areas of research, one of the areas of investigation. Or interaction design somehow is enriched by the understanding and design of the service system it belongs to. So there is a particularly connection, let's say, between these two fields. And you also, in your course, you are studying somehow this this topic because they are very, very interconnected. I imagine that you've already been hearing these concepts, no? I'm sure you heard about service interface, touch points, service interaction, customer journey, and so on. Because there are concepts that are used to describe really this part of a service where designers mostly focus. So a service interface is has been defined, for example, as the interaction area, the ambit, the scene in which the interactions between the service supply system and the users happen. So it's that mix of elements, physical, digital, people, information-based, that represent a set of elements with which a user interacts during the access to a specific kind of service. No? Some services are more dominated by physical spaces, some others are more based on human relations, and so on. But service interfaces are a system made of different elements. So we can see physical products with which we interact. It can be about information. It can be visual information like signposting, visual signs to orient people in complex environments, but it can be also simply a verbal communication with service staff. There are people, and people has their own appearance, so also how people is dressed and how they behave is fundamental, their practices, their expertise. And then the environment, so they can be both physical and virtual. So all these elements, the coordination of all these elements is what makes a service provision, the quality of the service provision. Other terms that are used in service design are, for example, service evidences. So evidences is a term just to explain that a service that is generally something intangible can have also some physical evidences, no? All service touch points like we have inherited from interaction design. So service touch points are the tangibles, the tangible elements that make up the total experience of using a service. So you often can hear using this term of touch points when you design or listen to some service designers talking about their projects. And they are fundamental elements because they help to make a service more tangible and more accessible. Another element, fundamental component of understanding services as interactions and interfaces is the time dimension. Because if we understand services as a journey or a cycle or a series of critical encounters that happen during over time, then our understanding of services change a lot. So they are not static, no? They are experiences that happen through different touch points along a timeline. And so it's somehow we need to imagine what can happen during this timeline, but also try to investigate, report, observe, measure, visualize. So the time dimension is a fundamental aspect of service provision. And within this idea of a service interface, somehow the service designer can be described almost as a director. Think about a theater, a movie director, somehow you have all these elements that should enable the performance, a performance to happen. The more these elements are designed and controlled, no, like for example in a retail coffee place, this branded coffee place like Caffè Nero or Costa or Starbucks and so on, you can see how services are very much following a strict choreography, a script that is particularly studied and controlled in all its elements, which is very different from a normal bar that you can find in Italy, where it's less designed, let's say, less controlled. One of the first fundamental tools that are used in service design as a consequence is the customer journey map, which is a visualization that with different styles, different interpretations, try to describe the journey of a user, representing the main and different touch points that characterize his interaction, his her interaction with the service. And you have been studying already some applications of these visualizations. You will be studying then with Francesca Piretta also different visualization tools and methods. As you can see from this picture, then the way this customer journey can be represented can be very diverse. So, you know, this is an example of a representation where you have pictures taken from a shadowing activity, and then main touch points are listed, the main actions from user and the suppliers are listed, and then they identify both issues and recommendations. So by doing this exercise, the designers are able to start reflecting on what issues they notice, what kind of recommendations they could give to the company. But also customer journey maps can be collaborative tools, so you can use these kind of visualizations to ask people to comment, add information, build their own interpretation of their own journey, and so it becomes also kind of a boundary object, an object that facilitates a co-design process. And it can be used also at different level of complexity. Sometimes in collaborative co-design sessions can be a simple format where people report the main activities of a user, a customer that they have in mind, adding an emotional line that somehow represents, for example, the up and downs of a journey, and maybe using post-it to suggest already some possible interventions to the process they have been mapping. So again, this is a very versatile tool that can be used in different ways with different levels and details of information. And I'm sure that you will meet this kind of instrument in different projects. Associated with the concept of service interface, service interaction, so on, is the service encounter, which comes from marketing. So service encounters is a term that wants to represent each moment of interaction between the user and the service system. And they have been generally applied in different ways and been studied in different ways. Some perspectives look at service encounter as being mainly social encounters, so trying to understand human interactions in services, and in other kind of studies I've been looking at service encounters as the totality of the user experience. As you can see, this is very old literature, so comes before the establishment of service design, I'm bringing you this perspective because anyway you need to get familiar with the key concepts around service design to then be able maybe to go deeper in more recent literature. So service encounter has been looked from two perspectives, one as a special kind of human interaction, and on the other side a service encounter is the contact moment of the client with all the elements of a service. So it's a more holistic perspective, no, and metaphors. And you can see that this is somehow reflecting the service interface concept that we saw before when introducing the service interface, the design perspective on service interaction design. So let's have a look at these two interpretations. The first interpretation that consider service encounter as a special kind of human interaction has been looking into the fact that people interact with people that are strangers, no? Maybe also talking about something that is very personal. Generally, there is an exchange of information. The roles are defined, and there are some expectations, no? If I have in front of me a retail agent or a doctor, I will have certain expectations, no? And it is said that there is a temporary suspension of social status differences. So whoever you are, if you go to the doctor, you should be treated in the same way. These kind of interactions are also defined dyadic as dyadic interactions. What does it mean? That there is a mutual influence between who is delivering the service and who is receiving the service. No? So depending on my expectations, my behavior and perceptions, this can influence the behavior, expectations, perception of the person interacting with me in the service. So it is fundamental to consider that there is a real-time development of service interactions that can't be controlled completely, no? Because maybe today that I'm giving a lecture, I'm ill, I'm not feeling very well, and so my performance will be of a diminished quality. Another important aspect that, again, belongs to older literature, but it's very relevant for when you design for a service, is the fact that the way we interact with the service is affected by our roles, our social roles, our roles also in interaction. What does it mean? That every time that we enter in a service, in particular if it's a new service, we need to understand how we should behave. And generally this is affected by the perceptions we have of the different people that are participating in the service. And why studying role is important? Because roles are somehow socially defined positions, okay? So every culture, roles are somehow learned from in our life. And so we have expectations. So if we, again, if we go to a primary doctor, we might have certain expectations if we are in Italy, if we go to China, if we go to France, if we go to Finland, we might have different expectations. And so there are also appropriateness of some certain behaviors. People might have privileges, duties, or obligations that are related to our social position. So when you design a service, you need to make these roles more evident, no? For example, if my understanding of the role of service provider is different from the actual behavior of the service provider, this lack of congruence can create a friction, no, a frustration. So I was expecting the doctor to behave in a certain way. I was expecting the taxi driver to behave in a certain way. So the congruence between what I, as a client, perceive as the role of the provider should be more aligned as much as possible. And the same is between what the service provider perceive as their own role and what the organization expects of their role in the organization. So this is very important because every time that we introduce a new service, we might be introducing new roles and new activities. Another aspect which is fundamental when we design a service is the concept of a service script. A script is a coherent sequence of events expected by the individual, involving him either as a participant or as an observer. So when we go to a supermarket, we expect a certain series of events. And often we do this mindlessness in a mindlessness way because we don't think about it because we learned how that situation happens. But if something changes, no, then we are back to a mindful way. So the way you pay in a supermarket has been changed and now you don't know what to do. Okay, so somehow when you design a service, you need to consider this, that people have been learning service scripts in all their lives. No? We have memories about what does it mean to go to a doctor, for example, no? Or what does it mean to go to a dentist. We have situational memories. If you create a new service model that requires a new service script, no, a new ways of interacting with the service, then of course you need to plan a certain educational process, no? So instructions, support. So, for example, when they introduce the new automatic machines in the train stations, there was personnel close to the machines to try to help people to learn the new script. Sorry for this slide that is over the size. What is important also when we study the role of service interfaces and service interactions is also fundamental to understand the role of employees, because employees has the role of gatekeepers. So they are the ones that mediate the interaction of the users with the organization. And so they are also image makers, because if I behave wrongly, no, I am ruining the image of my organization. And generally, in order to support employers to behave better, the general is not so much commanding, but equipping them, empowering them to have the right skills to carry out their roles. If we move instead to consider a service encounter as the interaction with all the elements of the service company, then we enter another reflection. Think about the IKEA as an example, no? IKEA is a typical example where the design of the space and the choreography of all the elements help you to navigate, no, a complex system where you have a certain amount of self-service. So in some kind of services, the interaction with people help you to solve most of the problems. In some other kinds of services, you need to be able to navigate a complex system through the choreography, the coordination of many different elements like the space, the layout, the information, the products, and so on. So the design of this complex system is surely something the service designer should become expert. And you can look at this service encounter mostly looking at the physical environment, which is a fundamental element of a service. And we might use environmental psychology as one of the possible references. Or you can use more The metaphor may be coming from theater, or anyway, considering more the service as a situation, as a social situation, which brings in other perspectives and other considerations. Okay, so the physical environment is somehow something that influences our behavior. There are studies looking into how hospital rooms affect your ability to, for example, to recover, no? Or some environments like an airport, no? We study the environment to see if people are able to navigate. So a service environment should be able to let people understand what they should do, so should give signs to help the comprehension of behavior expectations, should help to understand how to find services and critical infrastructures, and have a sense of how the organization works. Think about when you enter a restaurant, no? In some restaurants, you go straight to the table. In some restaurants, you need to wait for the waiter to sit you down. Sometimes you need to pay in advance. So what are the signs that help you to understand it? No? What are the elements that somehow guide you in your action with interaction with the service? Another concept that has been used in service research and service marketing is the one of servicescape, not landscape, servicescape. And this is an analytical way to interpret service environments with the idea that an environment is made by ambient conditions, specific spaces and layouts, specific signs, symbols and artifacts, and all of these elements can have an impact on how people react to the space. So there are some spaces that help us feel like at home, comfortable, we want to stay in the space, and some places, maybe for the music, the light, or the layouts, make us escape, no? We are not attracted. And so the study of all these elements is something that has been done in service encounter studies. Service encounters are not only the environment, the physical environment, but they are the mix of elements, people, products, signs, interactions somehow that create a specific situation. So it's very difficult to anticipate, it's very difficult to control completely. So there are places where things are more standardized, no? Where the effort is to control more the procedures. Of course, if we are in situations where there is a higher risk of failure and the impact of failure is higher, in other contexts where instead there is much more emergence, much more openness to the emergence of interactions and behaviors. A metaphor that has been used a lot in marketing is the one of the theater, because a service at the end is almost like a design of a performance, now where you have actors, you have the public, you have who are the participants, then you have a theater scene that represents the products, and then you have a performance which represents the process, let's say. And so sometimes using the concept of a theater can help to understand what does it mean to design a service. Also because you can use the concept of rehearsal, so the fact that somehow a performance needs to be prototyped and developed and tested and rehearsed in a way that it can reach the level, desired level. So this is the end of the first part of this lecture, and I will come back with the second part.